Good morning and a warm welcome to the first edition of Bharat Shakti, the Pondi Lit Fest 2018. For the first session of day two, to discuss gods, heroes, and demons, mythology for our times, we welcome Amish Tripathi, author of the Shiva trilogy and other best-selling books. Bibek Debroy, Chairman, Economic Advisory Council to the Prime Minister and member Niti Aayog. The session will be moderated by our own Nandini Sengupta, Pondicherry-based journalist and author of historical fiction. The session sponsor is Citroen. Due to the change of venue, we apologize for not being able to display our gratitude.
Good morning, Bibekta and Amish. We have a very distinguished panel today, and the subject is also equally colorful and interesting, and the two authors with me right here are absolute masters of this particular genre. So I'll start off by asking Bibekta, when we talk about heroes and demons in mythology, whether it is Indian mythology or Greek mythology, there's always a kind of gray line, isn't there? That sometimes the gods are demons, demons are gods, heroes are villains, villains are heroes. It's a kind of very nuanced portrayal that we see more in mythology, more across the world. Would you agree with that?
Thank you, Nandini, and good morning, ladies and gentlemen. In very, very broad terms, yes, but I do not like English words like demons and gods because they tend to confuse us more than anything else. But let me start with a few basics. In the Puran Itihas tradition, particularly the Puranas, there are pancha lakshanas, five signs that the Puranas are supposed to manifest. Of course, there are other Puranas like the Bhagavad Puran, which talks about 10. But fundamentally, these five are the original creation, sarga, the periodical cycles of creation and destruction, pratisarga, vamsha, which is the genealogy of the devas and the rishis, Vamshanucharit, which is the genealogies and the dynasties of the Surya Vamsha and the Chandra Vamsha, which is the itihas part of it, and the Manvantaras. Having said that, the word god, let's use the word deva. The devas are not Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwar. The word deva has an etymological root in shining. Deva, devi, devat, devata, these are all etymologically rooted in shining. The gods, as defined as the devas and not Brahma, Vishnu, Maheshwara or the Paramatman beyond that, they are all temporary possessions. They also come and go. They also have life and death. The title of Indra is a temporary one. So far as the demons are concerned, we have three words which are used synonymously. One is asura as an antithesis to the suras. We have daityas who are descendants of Diti. And we have the Danavas, who are the descendants of Danu. The Devas and the Asuras, they are cousins. And it is not a simple question of good versus evil, because there are stories to illustrate that even when gods like Indra get complacent and tend to misuse their power, they are dislodged. And even human beings like Nahusha has been temporarily Indra until he also got drunk with power. On the other hand, you have Asuras. And it's by no means clear that the asuras are necessarily evil. There were great asuras like Bali, for example, and I'm not even talking about Prahlad, and maybe we will come back to this. So they were asuras, either we interpret them as an allegorical terms in the sense that the deva element, the asura element is inherent in all of us, that's also possible. But if we regard them as depictions, it is not black and white. So that's how I would initially react.
I'll take this question now to Amish. When you have, you know, you've written about the Ram trilogy, the, you know, the Sayan of Ikkaku, your latest Sita. When you were talking about these mythological heroes and heroines, how conscious was it an effort on your part to make them, bring about this duality in them that Bibek is talking about, that there is a little bit of the asura in the deva, there may be a little bit of the deva in the asura. So when you're writing about these characters as a novelist, do you how interesting is this duality for you?
You know, I think building in on what Bibek Da said and on your question as well, I think there's a fundamental difference in how the ancient cultures approach philosophies and how the Abrahamic cultures approach philosophies. The Abrahamic cultures have been ascendant over the last 1500, 2000 years. And India is probably one of the last few surviving major ancient cultures. Even China, the pre-emperor Qin China, has largely been wiped out, very sadly, very sadly. It was a very deep culture. And neither way is right or wrong, it's just what suits that age or, you know, particular individuals. The ancient culture, the entire philosophical approach was to treat you like an adult. That the divine would not come down to earth and tell you, do this, 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 and you'll go to heaven. Do this, 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 you'll go to hell. That may be required also for some people, I'm not saying no. But in India and most of our ancient cultures, that was not the approach. The approach was, you're an adult. You have to grow up and take charge of your own life.
Yeah.
And you have to make your decisions and live with the consequences, positive or negative. Now, if you have to make your own choices, your own decisions, someone needs to teach you wisdom. Someone needs to teach you the ability to differentiate what are the choices and what are the consequences of those choices. That's what Viveka was, yeah? The ability to distinguish, the ability to make a wise choice. And once you've made a wise choice, even if the consequence is negative, there's no one to blame. There's no blame also. It's your choice. Correct? So in the traditional Indian way, there was no judgment either. It's not that God judged you. No one judged you. It's your choice, your decision, and you live with the consequences of your karma. That was one of the core philosophical precepts. Now, if we approach it from this perspective, then obviously our divine stories were different. Our divine stories were not prescriptive, were not that you have to do this, 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 this.
Right.
Our divine stories would build archetypes, that if there is an individual living a life of laws, what is that life like?
Right.
Now, you see that and you make your own choice.
Right.
Correct? So, Lord Ram's way of life teaches us what a life of laws is. You know, and there are various, you know, archetypes like this, Mata stories, Lord Krishna stories. So that was the perspective with which our stories were enumerated. And hence, obviously, then things are nuanced. Things aren't simplistic.
Right.
What that also means is that you have to take more charge of your life. It's not that if you've done bad karma, I worship this God, so I'm okay. No, it doesn't work that way. You have to take charge of your choices, of your karma.
So I'll ask you another question based on this. When you're talking about the Abrahamic religions becoming more prescriptive, whereas the ancient religions were not. Do you think it is a function of where those societies were at that point in time? So they needed those prescriptions, they needed the Ten Commandments, they needed the do's and don'ts, whereas the ancient civilizations had already come to a state where they could look at the entire gamut of options available to them and make their own choices. So was that a function of that?
Look, perhaps, you know, and it could also be that in the ancient, I think one of the reasons India survived also is that we would adapt to changing times. So there are parts of Indian philosophies which have actually become prescriptive, you know, maybe that was our reaction, you know, to a different philosophical challenge. But the entire perspective is that every way of life has its place. Purpose, yeah. Has its place. There's no way of life which is cursed by God as such, right? So you find the path that works for you. And therefore you'll find temples all having their own beliefs also. You know, like there's a, you know, debate on the Sabarimala temple. You know, there is the way the lens with which you approach it will actually impact what you think, you know, about it. If you're comfortable with multiple truths, then you approach it differently. But again, no way is completely right or wrong, because the problem with multiple truths is sometimes it leads to moral relativism.
Yeah.
So sometimes corruption comes in. Now, a reaction to that can be simplistic, like, you know, I'm sure, you know, at least people of my generation would have loved Amar Chittakatha comics. But delightful as they were, they presented things in a very simplistic way. Like the asuras are always green-skinned with horns. Have you guys noticed that? Yeah? Yeah, no, they're not described that way, you know, in our... And Amar Chittakatha, and I find so many people, you know, at events who tell me, no, this is bigotry because asuras were described that way. I said, but Amar Chittakatha comics are not a part of our scriptures, you know. I mean, you should read the original scriptures. But in a way, many of these comics and stories are a reaction to challenges, you know. And there's nothing wrong with that, because there is no law which can work forever. Change is the only constant. The very nature of philosophy is it has to adapt as times change. But you have to have that openness to realize that there is... Okay, let me put it this way. You have to have a mix of rigidity and flexibility. If you're so rigid that you're not able to adapt to changing times, then like a strong tree, when a hurricane comes, it falls.
Yeah.
But if you're so flexible, like you're like kusha grass, which everyone just walks all over you, then you have no identity of your own. You might as well not exist, right? So you have to have a ideal mix of rigidity so that you remain, but flexibility so that you can change with changing times. And that, I think, is perhaps one of the geniuses of the Indian way.
Bibekda, I'll now take the question to you. When we're talking about, let's not use heroes and demons, let's use devatas and asuras. It is indeed interesting that, you know, there is a Duryodhan temple, I'm told, somewhere in the hills of Uttarakhand. So does that show that, like, even in his fall, this character is also tragic enough, or in his way, right enough for people to actually build a temple and worship him? This ability to worship the both sides of the moral spectrum, is that unique to us?
Well, before I react to that, half the time in the Mahabharata, Duryodhan is referred to as Suryodhan. Even by Yudhishthira. But before that, let me take off on what Amish said and distinguish, I think it's an important distinction, between dharma and sadachar. Sadachar is good conduct. I think that this distinction is particularly specific to our tradition, that the two are not the same. Sadachar is very, very context specific. Sadachar is good behavior. And let me give you two illustrations. The first illustration, and I'm keeping it brief because of constraints of time, the first illustration is from the Mahabharata. Indra is angry with the world, it has not rained down for 12 years, people have been wicked, and because it has not rained down for 12 years, there is famine, there is drought, there is no food to be had. There's a rishi, his name is Vishwamitra. Vishwamitra was particularly prone to anger. Vishwamitra was starving, there was no food to be had. And there's a difference between rishis and munis, if you have noticed. Rishis typically married. Rishis typically taught. Munis typically did not marry. Munis was silent. Mona, the same root. Vishwamitra was a rishi. So he had married, so he had wives and children. Said there was no food, so he wandered around. He came to a village of Chandalas. The word used is not Chandala, but I'm simplifying. The word used is Swapaka, which is slightly different from a Chandala, but I'm simplifying. The Chandalas were known to keep dogs and also eat dogs. In one particular Chandala's house, in the courtyard, there was a rope strung there, and from that rope hung the carcass of a slain dog. The Chandala had eaten the forequarters and the hindquarters were hanging there. Vishwamitra waits for the Chandala to go to sleep. The Chandala goes to sleep. Vishwamitra tiptoes into the courtyard, begins to tug at this. But there are other dogs in the neighborhood. They began to yap and everyone wakes up. Chandala says, wakes up also and says, "Who are you?" Vishwamitra says, "I am the sage Vishwamitra. I am starving, I want to take this away to feed my wife and children." For about 12 chapters, a dialogue ensues between Vishwamitra and the Chandala. The Chandala is saying, "You are a Brahmana, you are a Rishi, you should not eat flesh. If you eat flesh, you should not eat the flesh of a dog, which is a polluted creature. If you eat the flesh of a dog, you should certainly not eat the hindquarters, which are more polluted than the forequarters." And Vishwamitra keeps saying, "The dharma comes later. First, let me live, then dharma." Debate goes on. At the end of it, Vishwamitra tells the Chandala, "Tell me, who is eating the flesh? Who am I? Am I this physical body or am I the Atman? If the physical body is eating the flesh, then how is it that I am tainted?" To this the Chandala says, "Rishi, take it away. I have no answer to your question." The second story I am going to illustrate is a story by Bertrand Russell. Bertrand Russell, I don't know how many of you know, also wrote short stories. They were terrible short stories, but they illustrated his philosophy. And there is a story known as The Boston Lady, which was published in 1972. And remember, 72, nuclear holocaust, the world is going to get destroyed. So various people get together and put a plane up there on 35,000 feet above the sky. And the idea is, when the earth is obliterated, humankind is destroyed, the people on that plane will repopulate the earth. It so happens that the plane crashes. The only one who is alive and is shipwrecked, I guess that's the right word to use, on an island is a pregnant lady from Boston. This lady gives birth to a son. The moot question before her is, in the interest of propagating the human species, should I have intercourse with my son? Which is more important? Eventually, she does have intercourse with the son. Also, eventually, the nuclear holocaust was averted. There was no disaster. She is rescued. And then she comes back to Boston, where she's shunned, censured by everyone in society, and the Boston lady eventually commits suicide. I do not think anyone steeped in our tradition would ever write such a story. Yeah. Because this is sadachar. Thou shalt not commit adultery. Depends on the context. Our notion is dharma and karma. You do what you think is right. And what you think is right may not necessarily be the same as what I do in exactly the same situation, and I receive the consequences, karma, and the devas were also subject to karma and dharma. And therefore, in our tradition, all that you have spoken about is sadachar, good behavior. In the Manusriti, most of the people, as someone said yesterday, the supporters and the detractors don't read the Manusriti. It starts by saying that this is a code of conduct for Satya Yuga.
Very interesting, Bibekda. Taking that dharma over to you, Amish, when you are talking about a hero, if I may use that word, like Ram, how does this dharma play out? I mean, if I may just take a step back from the moral perspective of the story and just look at it as a writer, as drama. How does this dharma play out in the drama, in the action and the drama that is Ramayana?
You know, I think perhaps to answer this, one has to also see what is the purpose of the Ramayana and Mahabharata in our education system. You know, sadly, many of us, at least the so-called educated Indians, believe that we had no education system, you know, before the great British came and saved us. You know, we were monkeys hanging from trees, apparently. But actually, we did have an education system. And how many of you guys have read the works of Dharampal ji? Oh, it's so sad, yeah. Only 3-4, okay. Guys, please, it's all free on the web. His books are out of copyright, especially The Beautiful Tree. Please read it. I'd strongly recommend it. Okay, but you should read various other books of his, find all his works. But if you have the time to read just one, read The Beautiful Tree. Dharampal ji had spoken of what our education system was like before the British came and destroyed it and then built their education system. And we had a system of Gurukul, Pathshalas, Madrasas for primary education. We had higher education. Of course, we had universities. Many of them were burned down, sadly.
Yeah.
I think the destruction, and in the last 1,000 years, we are so much more troubled by maybe the massacres that happened or some temples that were destroyed. I'm a very deeply religious person, but I think the biggest disaster to befall India was the destruction of Nalanda. Bakhtiyar Khilji.
And you know, the others as well, Nalanda, Udhantapuri, Vikramshila.
Yeah. We lost so much knowledge. And we are a country today with such low sense of history that the station you get off at to go to Nalanda University is called Bakhtiyarpur. The man who destroyed Nalanda University, Bakhtiyar Khilji. We named that area after him. But coming back, we lost a lot of our education system, okay, due to the British Raj. And if you find how our education system was structured, there was, you know, core text for maths, you know, like say Leelavati of Bhaskaracharya.
Yeah.
But the Ramayana and Mahabharata were taught everywhere, and the Ramayana and Mahabharata were actually, in a way, an introductory course to geography, to civics. That is the way, like, you're reading a fantastic story, and through that story, you're actually learning many things, right? Now, if you approach it from this perspective, then you realize Sugriv, for example, you know, when Lord Ram tells him that go find Sitama. Okay. Now, I remember when I was a kid, first time I heard this part of the Ramayana from my grandfather, I'd ask, everyone knew where Lanka was. Why Sugriv sending people around, you know, searching? Kya dhoond raha hai? And then, you know, I realized actually that entire section, that's what my Babaji told me, it's actually a geography lesson.
Mm.
Right? Sugriv is describing, you know, to his people that you go north, this will come. He's actually describing. You know, it's a geography lesson.
Yeah.
So when you see it from this perspective, you see the Ramayana and the Mahabharata in many ways as an entry educational course. And the Mahabharata tells you from a dharmic perspective, the entry educational course of a complex way of life. When there's tremendous change happening, when it's difficult to distinguish things, and from Lord Krishna's perspective, how this thing can be navigated by the rules of that age. The Ramayana is from a different perspective, because Lord Ram defines the straight and narrow, yeah. Right? That I will follow the laws no matter what. And you learn lessons on dharma from Lord Ram's life, from that perspective. So if you see it from that perspective, then a very simple lesson that you learn is, a way of life of laws is normally very good for a society, right?
But may not be so good,
so good for your personal life,
yeah.
Okay? Now this is a very simple, straightforward lesson, that you learn. And when you actually learn this lesson and you apply it to various others who also lived a life of a code, like say Gautam Buddha or Mahatma Gandhi, you realize the lesson applies actually.
Yeah,
right?
It does.
And there, again, like I said, in the traditional way, there is no judgment. It's not that this is right or wrong. You're just supposed to see this was an archetype, learn from it and apply in your own life. There is the exact opposite, as well, where you have the Dhritarashtra syndrome, where the family is, beyond all duties.
More
important. We've had leaders like that too, right? And again, in the Indian way, there is no judgment. You don't say he's a bad leader. You'll say, wow, what a fantastic parent, willing to sacrifice 1 billion people for their kid. Fantastic parent. No judgment. That's not the Indian way. And there's another perspective where a person is willing to sacrifice the entire family, right? For this thing. Is either way right or wrong? The answer is up in the air. In the Indian way, there's no judgment. You learn from it and then see what you can apply in your own life. That's a way to learn from Ramayana as well.
So I'll take this to Bibekda now. When we are talking about dharma, Amish just talked about Sugriv. The entire Bali episode in Ramayana and what happened to Bali, Ram's role in it, the greater purpose, how does that fit into this whole dharma concept?
Precisely, and I will again build on what Amish said, but first let me relate another story from the Mahabharata briefly and then I will answer your question. All of us knew that Bhishma had a vow of celibacy. At that time, stated very briefly, the princess, the eldest princess of Kashi, Amba, wanted to marry Bhishma. And Bhishma said, no, I have a vow of brahmacharya, I cannot marry you. And Amba said, if you do not marry me, I am going to immolate myself in the fire. And we all know what happened. Bhishma did not marry her, she immolated herself, became Shikhandi. What some people do not know is in the Mahabharata, Arjuna had a temporary vow of brahmacharya for 1 year.
Yeah.
At that time, the princess of the Nagas, Ulupi, fell in love with Arjuna. Arjuna said, following the vow of brahmacharya, Ulupi said, if you do not marry me, I am going to kill myself. So which dharma is more important to you? Your dharma of protecting brahmacharya or your dharma of protecting the life of a woman? Two kshatriyas, very similar positions, Arjuna decides to marry Ulupi. Now certainly there is a broader template, but within that what distinguishes our way of thinking, which is what Amish was saying, is that there is no absolute right or wrong. You take a decision, you suffer the consequences. Let me quickly state an anecdote about Bali and then I will come back to Bali. We know the story of Bali, the great Asura king, who donated the three worlds to Vishnu in the form of the Vamana avatar. And Bali, by the way, is going to be an Indra in the next cycle. Shukracharya, the precept of the gods, knew exactly what was going on. He knew that Vishnu had come in the form of a Vamana avatar. And Shukracharya says, please do not give him what you have promised to give him. Well, he says, I've already promised. In our way of thinking, before you agree to a pledge, well, before you do anything sacred, you touch water, but before you agree to a pledge, you say, Om. Shukracharya says, but you did not say Om. So what you promise does not hold. Vali says, doesn't matter. I may have forgotten to say Om, but my pledge is my pledge. Now link it to the Ramayana. You mentioned the Vali episode. There are other episodes also. There is the Shambhuka episode. In the Vali episode, before the Vali episode, Sugriv and Rama have taken a pledge. And Rama has promised Sugriv that he will ensure that Sugriv becomes the king. And in return, Sugriv has pledged that he will help Rama in searching out Sita. That is the context in which this happens. So again, Rama faces a conflict of dharma. In the Shambhuka instance also, there's a conflict of dharma because a brahmana comes and says that, look, as a king, you are not failing in your duty. So no absolute right or wrong. There is always a conflict of dharma. Going back to Suyodhan also had a case. It is not that he did not have a case.
Yeah,
so in each and every instance, I endorse what Amish said, these were supposed to tell us that the world is not there in black and white, it's in shades of grey. You take your decision and you suffer the consequences. There was a famous sage named Kaushik. He was meditating in the forest. There were some passers-by who were chased by bandits. And there was a fork in the road. The passers-by went along one route. The bandits came along and asked the sage, Kaushik, which way did they go? The Kaushik, being a truthful sage, said, that way. And the bandits pursued the passers-by and killed them. As a result of this, Kaushik suffered the consequences and went to Naraka. So it's not, thou shalt speak the truth. Everything is relative. That's the fundamental notion.
This relativity, Amish, coming back to you, how does it play out when in the actual sort of drama of say the Mahabharata? We were talking about the Ramayana now, but I want to sort of move to the Mahabharata a little bit, because the Mahabharata is even more complex. It's even more political story. How does it play out there, and how does it? Do you think there's a very strong connection, even though these myths were written thousands of years ago? Is a strong connection to what we see today? It's relevant in the way our lives are unfolding today politically as well.
I think these texts are relevant for all times, precisely because they are not prescriptive. It's not that they are telling you a set of rules which you suddenly find is not working, you know, and then you move away from those rules. There's nothing to convert into or convert out of. These are essentially, you know, through the medium of fantastic, really fantastic storytelling, you're learning lessons on life. And because all of us are different, all of us are at different stages in life, all of us have different gunas, different attributes, different swabhav, different, you know, characters. Because we are different, the lessons we'll draw from the same incidents are different. And that's why they have so many. You'll notice that the storytelling style in the Ramayana and Mahabharata is a lot like how hypertext links are, you know, in modern, you know, and when you're studying these days, you'll be reading a text on a website and you find some subject that intrigues you. You can click on it, you know, and go deeper into there and then come back, right? So in the Ramayana and Mahabharata, if you think about it, are actually structured this way. There is a core story, And then they keep going into flashbacks, flash forward, either, other, because there is a point where you're supposed to think of some incident and learn something. You know, and they structure it that way. And it's not that the Ramayana is not nuanced either. It's just that the character of the journey of the main character, which is Lord Ram, that is different, so it appears different. But the Ramayana is equally nuanced as the Mahabharata. It's just that it was for a different age, that's all. And also, for many of us, we, again, urban, educated Indians, our conception of the Ramayana is largely drawn from a 1980s television series.
Yes.
Which was simplistic. Yes. Again, not to deny nothing wrong with that, and not to deny when the history of India is updated 50 years later, Ramanand Sagar, I'm telling you, will be seen as one of the seminal contributors. Okay. So not to deny its strength and power, but yes, that TV serial was relatively simplistic. It was made for an India of that age. If you read the original Valmiki Ramayana, there are so many versions of the Ramayana, you know, and the Adbhut Ramayana, you know, there are so many. The 1980s TV serial was largely on the Tulsi Das Ramcharitmanas, and wherein the Tamil area, there's a Kamban Ramayana out here. There's a very famous scene. I don't know how many of you guys have read the Kamban Ramayana? Yeah? Remember that famous scene where Lord Ram and Ravan actually praise each other? There's a scene where they actually say words of praise for each other. Not face to face, but words of praise for each other. That scene is also there. In the Adbhut Ramayana, there's this lovely Sanskrit shloka. Of course, all of you have heard of Yada Yadai Dharmasya.
Yeah.
Yeah, from the famous one from the Mahabharata. There's a version of that in the Adbhut Ramayana. Yada Yadai Dharmasya Glanir Bhavati Suvrata. Not Bharata, Suvrata. Abhyutthanam Adharmasya Tada Prakruti Sambhava. That whenever adharma rises or dharma is in decline, remember, O keeper of righteous vows, the mother will incarnate. The mother goddess will incarnate. This version is there in the Adbhut Ramayana, which is also credited to Valmiki ji. There are, even the Ramayana is very nuanced. Sadly, we don't read it. Our education system is completely colonial. We teach nothing of it. So many of us still believe what the British told us our culture was. So many of us still believe Sati was a major practice. You know, Meenakshi Jain, I'm a huge fan of Meenakshi ji, and she has written a very important book on this. And there are so many Indians who actually believe Sati was a major practice. It was not, dude, it was not. You know, like I said, the entry text into our culture, if our entire culture is a graduation course, Ramayana Mahabharata is the first standard. It's like the entry level. Okay? Make a list of the widows in the Ramayana and Mahabharata. Who committed Sati in there? Who? Huh? Wife of Meghnath? One? Okay, admitted. But you'd make the list of others. Okay? And Meghnath, again, she didn't say, I'm committing Sati. She said, I don't want to live anymore because my husband is. Madhuri also killed herself, but that was because she felt guilty that she had caused the death of her husband. It was not Sati. Okay? So, Kaushalya Ma, Sumitra Ma, Kaikeyi Ma, you look in Mahabharata, none of them committed Sati. It was not a major practice. But sadly, many of us Indians actually believe it's a major practice because we haven't read any of our texts and we haven't been taught anything. We need to explore a lot more, and there's nuances in all our texts. None of them are simplistic. I'm not saying Sati didn't happen. It did happen in a few communities. But it was very, very, very minor. Very minor.
I'm going to take this opportunity to ask you, Vivek, that you were just talking about Narak. Can you just explain how our concept of Narak is different from the Abrahamic concept of hell? And where does morality play a role in both?
And there is Patal. One should not confuse the two. Well, I use Patal as a generic term. There are seven worlds, the earth upwards, and there are seven worlds that are in the nether regions. in the Netha regions, Patal is one, Rasatal is another one, so on and so forth. Narak is hell. The Netha regions are not hell. Depending on your karma, which does not last for infinity unless you have attained moksha, you can go to Swarga, you can go to Narak. Until your paap or punya has been exhausted. So it is not for eternity. Once your time in Swarga or in Narak, and there are actually 64 different Narakas depending on the kind of sin you have committed. Once your papa punya has been exhausted, you are born back into this cycle of life sansara. And the objective of moksha, liberation, is to liberate oneself from this cycle. The same individual in the same life or after the same life can go to both Swarga and to Narak. And there have been actual instances of people going to Swarga. So the main difference is, it is not till kingdom come, till the drums sound. It is temporary, and then you are born back into this cycle of sansara.
How about a similar definition of heaven and Swarga?
Oh, Nandini, just one second. I forgot to say something. I just wanted to add something to what Amish has said. It's not that the Mahabharata is more complicated. The issue of conflict of dharma is similar across both. Why does the Mahabharata seem more complicated? To me, the Ramayana is like a long story. And what is my definition of a long story? A story is written from the point of view of one main protagonist, which is what the Ramayana is, Ramayana. A novel ideally captures the views of many protagonists. In the Mahabharata, there are many different protagonists, all of whom face this conflict of dharma. That is the reason why it seems to be more complicated. But that essential trade-off, that what do I do, that's common across both.
Yeah, that's true. No, but it's also a multiplicity of main characters.
Yes,
in Ramayana, you have Rama, you have Ravana, you have the main characters are very well defined. Yeah. In Mahabharata, it's almost like an enormous, you know, sort of embroidered quilt.
To use a modern Westernism, the Mahabharata is like an ensemble cast.
Yes.
And Ramayana is the journey of a hero.
Hero. Yeah. Absolutely. But obviously, because what I was trying to talk about when I said nuances, because of the politics in the Mahabharata, vis-a-vis the politics in Ramayana. The Ramayana also has politics, but they are different. Would you like to maybe talk a little bit about that?
Politics
of Ramayana versus the politics that we see in Mahabharata.
No, because actually in a way, both of them and all our stories in that sense were essentially explorations of dharma.
No, what I was trying to say is that, for instance, in Mahabharata, if you look at what happens at the end of that war, this battle ends, yes,
and in Devaloka you find the
you have annihilation. So out of that emerges maybe a new order, maybe a new sort of because that current entire aristocratic society is gone. Both sides are annihilated. In the Ramayana, it is also a change, but it is a change of a different kind. So, is there a political message there?
No, but actually, I won't look at it that way. I don't know if Bibekda would agree with that, but I won't look at it that way. Because one of the things in the Indian way is the approach to time. It's not linear. There is no, you know, this is where it all began, there was nothing before this, this is the permanent end. Time is circular. In fact, actually, if you go deeper, it's like kind of more like a spiral, actually. Okay. So, till the cycle of creation and destruction is happening, the story never ends, in a way.
Right.
You know. So, yes, everything got destroyed and a new thing would start. Whereas here, you're somewhere in a different
trajectory.
If you're seeing time as circular, then what is the beginning? What is the end? You know, in this. Because it's constantly moving. Change is the only constant. And the perspective to look at all our ancient stories, the Ramayana and the Mahabharata, that essentially the core objective is to explore different facets of dharma. Yeah.
Right.
So, many of the Western movies that we see, even the Bollywood movies that we see, a lot of it is actually, Bollywood movies have been impacted hugely by Persian storytelling style. Persian storytelling style, I've been told, I'm not really sure, but apparently has been impacted by Aristotle's poetics, where a story is supposed to have a beginning, middle and conclusion, and the ending has to give you a sense of conclusion, either some real cathartic, really depressing end, or some happy ending, correct? And you're supposed to kind of enjoy that journey. It could be a love story, it could be anything, which is not necessarily the point in the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. Often if you see at the end, like in the Mahabharata, when you have Kauravas, in heaven, and that's how the Mahabharata ends, right? All of you have, do you know the ending of the Mahabharata? Not the television serial, the actual text, right? At the end, the Pandavas are climbing Devalok. One by one, they keep falling. The only one who reaches is Yudhishthir, and a dog, of course, there's, which is symbolic, and he finds the Kauravas out there. And then you think, Sala, ye kya ho gaya? Correct? What is the point of that entire battle? Dharma Kshetre, Kuru Kshetre, and those guys are there. Even in the Ramayana, that the entire battle, it was essentially a battle to save his very high moral wife, a goddess. And then it ends that way. Because the entire perspective has actually, it's not supposed to give you a sense of conclusion. The story itself is not important. The entire point of the story is to make you think about dharma. And you think about dharma when you're troubled, when you're thinking of questions. If you're satisfied and ribbon has been tied in the story and it's been forgotten, then you stop thinking, right? And that's the way to approach the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. There is no key. This was an ending and so a new thing. There's nothing like that. It's all actually about learning different facets of dharma. And what can make you learn that, that is the perspective of the storyteller. Anything which will force you to think.
Bibekda, taking this again over to you, in the Mahabharata also there are these, we talked about Bali, we talked about in the Mahabharata there is this entire story about this Eklava and the questions that those throw up. In your view, what kind of dharma message do those stories give us? What kind of dharma options do those, may not be message but options, do those stories throw us? And if you can just take us through that.
My plea to everyone is to read the texts in unabridged form, in Sanskrit if you can, if not in Sanskrit, in some other language, not read them in abridged form.
May I just cut in? Bibekda is too polite to do this, so I will do it for him. Please read his translations. They are fantastic. Okay.
The reason is, if you have the Amar Chitra Katha versions, things tend to be simplified. And the great narrative now is Ekalavya, representative of the oppression of the scheduled tribes, which is why I think you asked me the question. Scheduled tribe is a definition that originates with the British. I don't think we should necessarily bring in a British schedule to try and understand what happened in the Mahabharata. Ekalavya was the prince of the Nishadas. Do remember that there was a conflict across kingdoms, and Ekalavya's father was the general of Jarasandha's army when Jarasandha attacked the Yadavas and drove them out of Mathura. Also remember that outside of the Kurukshetra war, who killed Ekalavya? Krishna did. So the Ekalavya side of the Nishadas were adversaries in that political sense. Remember that. Remember also that Nala Damayanti, Nala was the king of the Nishadas. We will not say ever that Nala was a scheduled tribe. Guha who ferried Rama across was a Nishada. We will never say Guha was a scheduled tribe. We will say that only for Ekalavya. Before the Ekalavya incident happens, there was an occasion when Dronacharya had gone with the five Pandavas to have a bath in a river, and his thigh was grasped by a crocodile, oblique alligator, and Arjuna saved him. Dronacharya tells Arjuna, after he was saved by Arjuna, because of this I will ensure that you are the greatest archer on earth. Ekalavya incident, two different things happen. First is Ekalavya comes to Dronacharya and wants Dronacharya to teach him. Dronacharya, remember, was employed, salaried employee of the Kauravas.
Yeah.
If you read the actual text, Dronacharya says, I have been employed to teach the sons of kings. He does not say Kshatriyas. So by implication, had it been an ordinary Kshatriya, Dronacharya would have refused. So I can't teach you. Subsequently, Ekalavya learns and we come across Ekalavya, who's become a skilled archer. The Pandavas also witness this. Arjuna goes to Dronacharya and says, what is this? You promised me you would be the greatest archer. So Dronacharya again faces this conflict of dharma. Is my pledge more important, or is human cruelty, etc., more important? And that's when he takes the decision to ask for the thumb. So my plea to everyone is, please read the original. There are nuances which we tend to forget. And before we are nearing the end, sometimes it is possible to short-circuit karma and do tapasya and do notice. And it's obvious, but nonetheless I'm mentioning it. Do notice that the problems are invariably created by Shiva and Brahma, who indiscriminately grant boons. Shiva is Ashutosh and also Ashurosh, and then Vishnu has to come along and resolve the problem.
But as a beneficiary of Lord Shiva's blessings, you know, a completely unworthy beneficiary, I'm not complaining.
Yeah, so far we have been actually talking only about the Ramayana and Mahabharata, but you brought in Lord Shiva. If we take out this same dharma principle to Shiva, can you just talk a little bit about how that plays out with him?
You know, it's a little difficult with him, because I'm not saying that just because I'm a Shaivite and, you know, and a very proud devotee, but look, Lord Shiva is anadi, you know. There's no beginning, there's no end. Even the stories of him in all the Shaivite Puranas, you know, the Linga Puran, there are more incidents where you learn something from. It's not in the nature of an entire text like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata. So it's kind of difficult to draw lessons from his journey as such, because
but
it's not really.
But you get glimpses of him, right?
Yeah, but you get glimpses of him in terms of, as I think Bibekda said rightly, the, you know, because he's someone who comes in and, you know, and presses the button and changes things.
Yeah.
You know, and in the Ramayana, and it has to be remembered, both sides were devotees of Lord
of
Shiva.
Him, yeah.
Right. You know, Lord Ram, then Ravan and Valmiki ji. I mean, even he was also believed to be a devotee of Lord Shiva. So I think it's difficult to box him into this, and it may be difficult to do that with Lord Vishnu as well. But because Lord Vishnu has avatars,
yeah,
we go through the stories
avatar,
of the avatars.
Yeah.
Lord Shiva had anshas as well, you know. So Hanumanji is an ansh of Lord Shiva. Jalandharji is an ansh of Lord Shiva. But I guess maybe the, you know, the way philosophies are approached out there are is a little different. Difficult to put it in a journey like this. I've tried to do it with the my books.
Yeah.
Shamelessly plugging it.
I think the Shiva, Vishnu, Brahma thing is a red herring, because they are manifestations of the same thing. And as here most people probably know, not outside, metaphorically, the syllables of Om, they capture all three different ways. This is a slightly simplistic way of thinking about it, but I'm sort of putting it forward. They generally think of where Shiva is. Generally, Shiva is in the mountains. And think of the Shiva lingas. Several of them are in the mountains, formed out of ice.
Yeah.
Whereas Vishnu is Narayan, he's lying down on the water. And where is Brahma? Brahma, for a story that I don't have time to tell, has only one single temple, strictly speaking, in the entire country, that is in Pushkar. So, purely simplistically, one can think of this as three different forms of water necessary for life. One Shiva in solid form, one Vishnu in liquid form, and the gaseous form of water is air, which you don't really see, and Brahma is the creator of that breath of life that flows through all of us. But as I said, these are sort of artificial distinctions.
And if I can add just one more thing also to what you said. If you see the list of the names of Lord Shiva, which is there in some of the Shaivite Puranas, one of the names listed there is actually Vishnu. And if you read the Vishnu Sahasranam, which all devout Vaishnavas would be chanting every morning, one of the names listed there is Shiva. So he's right, yes, as we go deeper into the philosophies, we are supposed to learn that the source is the same. Just the manifestations are different because we are different. So we need a different manifestation for us to make sense of that, of the principle.
Of the principle, yeah. Right. So, Vivekda, coming back to a little bit to Mahabharata again, when you talk about dharma and how the dharma plays out in various layers in the story, do you think that the choice of some of the characters are, particularly say the Pandavas, who are by no means perfect, but they all all go through their choices, as do the Kauravas. Do you think that they are not perfect, that they are all making these choices at various levels, is also driven by the dharma equation?
There is a side point I want to make, that both of these were poetry, but please do understand the nature of the poets were completely different. Valmiki was a poet who reveled in descriptions of nature. Vedavyas was a poet, but he was a very prosaic kind of poet. He was not interested in nature. He was interested in who's hitting whom and who's doing what and what are the incidents.
Lots of action.
So let us not recognize that if two different authors compose something with the same fundamental premise, they will compose it differently. And let me also bring in something else, particularly because I just noticed that Dr. Shampanand Mishra is sitting there. Anushtup Chanda. The Anushtup Chanda has several characteristics. One of these is 8 aksharas in every line. Dharma Kshetre, Kurukshetre, Samaveta, Yudhsavas, Anushtup. If you are a skilled poet, you can compose poetry with that 8-akshara style very easily. But if you are not skilled, if you have a name, it is easier to handle a name which has 4 letters because of the Anushtup structure, right, than 3. Many men had letters, names with 4 letters. Women typically had names with 3 letters. Now, trying to do Anushtup Chanda, if I am not that skilled, with Draupadi is very difficult. With Yagyashayini it is easier. With Bhima it's a little bit difficult, so I will call Bhima Brikodara. So here we have Shakuntala, 4 letters, and the Shakuntala in the Mahabharata is much, much more powerful as a character than Shakuntala. And maybe all that the person was doing what was poetically easier, namely Shakuntala and Satyavati and Yagyasehi, and several years down the line we are now debating whether this reflected misogyny in the Mahabharata or not. Having said that, on the Mahabharata, a link to what you were earlier discussing with Amish, the Mahabharata essentially happens along an east-west axis, Uttarapat.
Yeah.
And it's a resolution of the struggle amongst kingdoms at that point, and the Mahabharata is also 100,000 shlokas. The Valmiki Ramayana happens along a north-south axis where there weren't that many major kingdoms. And it is just 24,000 shlokas. So let us understand that because the geography was different, because the poets were different, there are differences which have crept in. This does not mean that any particular sense that the Mahabharata is trying to convey a different notion of Dharma and the Rama and the Valmiki Ramayana is trying to convey a different. However, there is also this, that the sections of the Ramayana Khandas, the sections of the Mahabharata Parvas, both of them are branches, except a parva is a more flexible branch of a tree. A khanda is a thicker branch. The Mahabharata is more flexible. It's like when we used to travel as kids on trains, they used to be holdalls. So the Mahabharata is like a holdall. Everyone dumped everything into the Mahabharata. For the Ramayana, whenever someone was unhappy with what Valmiki had depicted, he or she came along and composed another Ramayana.
Yeah.
So inherently the nature of the two texts are somewhat different.
Would you like to add something to that?
No, I mean, because he's, he's probably one of the foremost Sanskrit scholars around. So I think the insight that he gave with this last answer was very deep. And my family, unfortunately, and my grandfather, he was a Pandit in Kashi and he done a master's in Sanskrit, but each generation going downwards are sadly pressures of career, pressures of, because as Babaji used to say, unke paas Saraswati Ma ki, he had a lot of blessings of Saraswati Ma, but very little blessings of Lakshmi Ma. So, and we have, In our each generation, we've tried to compensate that, and sometimes we overcompensate it. And so many of the nuances which come in only when you have a deep knowledge of the language itself. Which in our language, which in our family, I'm telling you, every generation has become less because of the pressures of building a career and everything else. That itself gives you such a deeper understanding of the text itself. And the insight that Bibekda gave actually things that even more we need to revive Sanskrit in our country. There was, reading the Constituent Assembly debates depresses one because we'd come very close to making Sanskrit, the official language which would have revived it. And many of the people who fought for Sanskrit were actually from South India and many of the scheduled caste MPs. It's little known. And the people who opposed them were, many of them were North Indian upper caste MPs. And it's a strategic blunder because of which we are still suffering. We have to work at reviving Sanskrit, the depth of understanding that you get just by knowing the language, he just displayed it, you know, so beautifully.
Bibek, the Sanskrit and the importance of Sanskrit, because what Amish is just talking about, that as we move away from the language itself and read these myths, these stories in languages other than Sanskrit, whether they're translated in English or Hindi or Bangla or whatever, you're still, something is lost in translation. Would you agree with that?
A lot actually is lost in translation. Sanskrit is a language, and I'm very hesitantly looking at Dr. Sampanand Mishra in case he frowns. Sanskrit is a language where all words have their origins in verbal roots. Consequently, the same word can have multiple meanings. And when you are translating, regardless whether you're translating into English or you're translating into some other language, perhaps 75% of the time, it's obvious which meaning you are going to take, particularly as you get familiar with the style of an author. The more and more I read of Amish and Nandini Sengupta, I will become familiar with the style. But there are instances where you do not know which meaning is the right meaning, because the meaning in that particular society, in that particular context, may have been completely different from the first primary meaning. Sure. Sometimes the meaning is a very obscure meaning. Sometimes, like for example, I'm translating the Markandeya Puran now. In the Markandeya Puran, right towards the beginning, there is a reference to Duryodhana as Valaram's Jamatri.
Really?
But what? The Markandeya Puran has been translated in English twice and in various other languages several times. So I looked up all of these. And lo and behold, all of them have understandably translated as son-in-law.
Mm.
It makes no sense.
Mm.
Yes, there was some story about Duryodhana's son being married to Valarams, etc., etc., but by no stretch of the imagination it is son-in-law. Doesn't make sense. So I looked up the Moniyar Williams, I looked up the Apte. Finally, in Vachaspati, I find a meaning which is the eighth meaning of Jamatri, which says someone who's loved. And I'm just stating this as an illustration of how, when you are translating so many years down the line, it is perfectly possible to get things wrong, even more so in English, where there are some words you cannot satisfactorily translate into English.
And that, could that be one of the reasons, do you think, that the way we have approached our myth, one is, of course, it's in popular culture, in popular literature, it has been simplified. But the other reason also is that we are no longer in touch with that language, so we are sort of losing the nuances that drove those stories in the first place.
Yeah, no, it's very true, because each language has its own core culture, a culture that a language emerged from. And without you realizing it, when you speak that language, it actually, that culture, that thought system, it actually gets embedded in your mind without you even realizing it. Like, have you guys noticed that in English, the masculine god is always with a capital G, the female goddess is with a small g?
Yeah.
Have you guys noticed this? And the plural gods are also small g.
Small g.
Okay. You don't realize it when you're reading in English from a young age, it gets embedded in your mind. Male god superior, female goddess lower. It gets embedded in your mind because that's the language you're reading and learning. In Sanskrit, is there a difference between male god and female goddess? No? No, there isn't. That, it gets embedded, that culture gets embedded in your mind because you're speaking that language. In Sanskrit, you know, in Vedic Sanskrit, there's no translation for the English word blasphemy. You know, how many of you guys have read 1984?
Oh, sorry.
Yeah? You know, one of the brilliant core philosophical concepts of that book is if you remove the word to teach you a concept, how will you even think of that concept? You don't have a word to express that thought in, correct? Now, that didn't mean that there was some concept of blasphemy in Vedic Sanskrit. They removed the concept, didn't exist. Mm. So there was no word for it, so you wouldn't even have thought of it as a concept. It wouldn't even enter your mind that you cannot question gods or goddesses, because there is no word for it for to even think that thought. Mm. Correct?
Correct?
So language always expresses in very deep ways the culture that it emerged from. So we have not just lost, you know, the ability to understand our texts. We have fundamentally been, you know how trees are uprooted and replanted? That's what has been done to us. We have been fundamentally replanted. Correct? And since our beginning learning is in English, our medium of instruction is English, we actually have to unlearn and relearn some concepts. Like, you know, for someone, for an Indian to actually speak of blasphemy is nonsense. The concept is not there in the Indian way.
Yeah.
You should question politely, but you have every right and duty to question.
Yeah.
That has got lost with our inability to revive Sanskrit.
As a Sanskritist, Bibekda, do you think, what way do you think this, even if for those who don't know the language, somebody like my generation, we don't know, we haven't learnt that language. But for younger people also, how can Sanskrit be made more relevant, at least from the point of view of storytelling? Simply from the point of view of storytelling, if not anything else.
I think the problem is, we have a session on Sanskrit later in the day. I think the problem is that somehow in the mind there is an idea that Sanskrit is very difficult. Kimashcharjam vayam atra asmin sabhagrihe sanskrita vishaye angal bhashayam vartalapan kurmaha. I think everyone understood this. So difficult. We will say Pone Gara and we will not realize it is Padona. Pad is a quarter, it's a quarter short. We will say Swai Gara and we will not realize that is Sapada, quarter after. We will say Kripaya and we will not realize this is Tritiya Vibhakti. So I think we have unnecessarily made it seem as if Sanskrit is a difficult language, as if Sanskrit is a dead language. It becomes a dead language if we make it a dead language. Otherwise, it is, for Indians certainly, it is a perfectly easy language to pick up. And every translator will make mistakes. If one is reading the Upanishads, that's difficult. If one is reading the sutras, including Patanjali, it is difficult.
Mm.
The reason being, a sutra is a thread. This is oral transmission. So I have to remember it through brief cryptic statements. To understand those, I need interpretations. But if one is talking about Puran Itihas, it is very, very simple language. I think everyone can understand.
So I think we have just about 15 minutes left. We will open the floor to questions.
Thank you. I'll just make one question. Of course, I have one. But before that, one observation and suggestion. That when we look at all our mythological stories in the Puranas and try to interpret it in terms of Puranas, in terms of Mahabharata and Ramayana, we don't do full justice to the stories, the episodes, the characters, the events which are there. So those have to be interpreted in relation to the Vedic realization. So unless and until we enter into the Vedic realization, the same concept of Indra or Brihaspati or any other innumerable gods and goddesses. When we look at the Vedic deities, for example, I'll tell you that in Hinduism, the word Bhagavan and Bhagavati is so important, and in the Vedas, it doesn't exist. The word Bhagavan and Bhagavati doesn't exist. These two words do not exist in the Vedas. So if we have to explain what is Bhagavan and what is Bhagavati in Puranic term, so Puranas give different definitions, so which doesn't fit. So only when we turn to the Vedas, then only we can understand the real significance of what is Bhagavan and Bhagavati. This is what one suggestion which I wanted to make, like when we talk about mythology, gods, and different events and episodes in the Puranas, so we can't neglect the Vedic realization. The question which I wanted to ask is to Bibek Da. So you made one statement that Manusmriti is meant for Satya Yuga, the code of conduct. So as a student of Sri Aurobindo and the mother, so what we know is that in Satya Yuga, the man is guided by its pure nature. Guided directly by the divine law, he transcends all codes of conduct. So how does it fit?
I don't know how it fits, but towards the beginning of Manu Sangeeta, my statement was that we should read these. Towards the beginning of Manu Sangeeta, what happens is something like this, as stated in the Manu Sangeeta itself. The codes of dharma, as practiced in Satya Yuga, were lost in the deluge. Now Manu is stating them. As it is, if you read the Manu Sangeeta, it is by no means obvious whether it is normative or whether it is descriptive. If it is normative, then nowhere does it state that this is normative for Kali Yuga, which is the yuga we are in. What is the concept of Satya Yuga? The concept of Satya Yuga, of course, is that people were naturally prone to dharma. So therefore you did not really need the king, therefore you really did not need a court. The Manu Sangeeta is the basis for a lot that we practice. But let us at least read it. To give one example from the Manu Sangeeta, the what people should eat and what people should not eat in the Manu Sangeeta, they were almost exclusively for Brahmanas. Almost exclusively, on occasion some references to Kshatriyas, but the Manu Sangeeta says that Brahmanas, amongst the various things that they are entitled to eat, is a fish known as the Rohit fish, which people from the eastern regions are familiar with as the Rui Mach, the Rohit. Simple question, who caught that fish? If I assume that very simplified structure of society in accordance with the four varnas, the Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya and Shudra, catching fish was not one of the sanctioned occupations for either Brahmanas or Kshatriyas or Vaishyas or Shudras. So therefore there must be people who caught fish. Therefore, this fourfold structure is an extremely, extremely simplified structure of what actually happened. For example, Satyavati was descended from the fisher folk. So that is my plea. Also in the Manu Sangeeta, there is a statement in the Manu Sangeeta, since the figure varies across Sangeetas, I will not give the precise figure, but essentially it says something like this. Brahmanas, when they borrow, the rate of interest shall be X percent per month. When Kshatriyas borrow, it shall be Y percent per month, and it's more. Vaishyas, the rate of interest is more, and for Shudras, it is even more. Hmm. And all kinds of people, beginning with Max Moller, have said, look at these people, even the interest rate is linked to the Varna system. In one of the other Sritis, I think it is Gautam Sriti, it says something like this, and Amish will be delighted at this. What will Brahmanas borrow for? Small sums of money for sacrifices. What will Kshatriyas borrow for? For fighting. Very risky, larger sums of money. Vaishyas will go off on ships to trade, larger sums of money, even more uncertain. So this is actually risk premium being built into the interest rate. Now, had we said risk premium should be part of the interest rate, people would have applauded because the World Bank has said it. Now, because it is there in the Sritis, we will condemn it. Now, before you ask, what were Shudras? Shudras, essentially conspicuous, these are my words now, conspicuous consumption do not add to productive potential. Now, you may agree or disagree, all I am pointing out is let us read and understand.
More questions? Some from the kids? Some from the kids at the back?
Just shout your question.
Shout it out, no? No, you just shout it out, no? It's okay.
When you start? My question is that after the year that you told, gods have life and death. Gods have life and death. So, now the Greek gods will exist or not? We think that they are already dead because civilization has died.
I can't hear you actually very well.
His question is, gods have life and death. So do the Greek gods exist today or not?
The Greek gods exist today or not? And what is the difference between the Vedic gods and the Puranic gods and today's god? And do you think anything about the future gods? Because your title is like that. I think we should discuss much about that. And we have spoken more time in Ramayana and Mahabharata. Thank you.
For the Greek gods, in all fairness, you should ask a Greek. I shall not comment on the Greek gods. I repeat my plea. Please read our texts. Because I already told you there are manvantaras that have passed, there are manvantaras that will come. We are in the seventh manantara. The present set of gods are gods for the seventh manantara. If you read the text, the descriptions of the future manantaras, you will find a list of the people who will be gods in the next manantara, a list of the saptarshis who will be the saptarshis in the next manantara, for each manantara, the person who will be the Indra. Now, if you expect me now to reel off the names, is that what you expect? I presume not. But that entire list is there. Future, past. And as I told you, Bali will be the Indra in the next manantara. Just as Ravana, in case you do not know, will be a Tirthankara in the future.
Yes, Doc.
The Abrahamic traditions, life is a single episode based on which God loves us so much that he may send us to hell, which is eternal, or to heaven. But in the Indian tradition, heaven and hell are temporary, but you mentioned that our karma gets worked out in those regions. That is something which I would like to understand more, because my own understanding is that karma gets worked out here on earth, and it is only the rasa of that life which is extracted in those regions.
The notion of karma is a very, very complicated notion. interpretations of karma also vary widely. And you did not quote the Bhagavad Gita back at me, so I shall not quote it back at you, saying that the notion of karma is one that even wise people have not understood. But to the extent it is a balance sheet, some of this balance sheet is extinguished in this life. But everything is not extinguished in this life. And for us, this life is just one little segment in our much longer existence. Whatever is not extinguished in that balance sheet, assets as well as liabilities, we carry forward. As depicted in the Puranas, even the Mahabharata, Ramayana also actually, some of that gets extinguished in Swarga and Naraka. Whatever still remains is carried forward in to your next birth, which may or may not be in the form of a human.
Any more questions? Yeah, go ahead. Just come forward, no? We can't hear you.
Sir, actually I remember what I read in Odia. When Gandhari's sons come to her to seek her blessings, she says, Punya rahau jai, dharma rahau jai, which means may victory reside with the side of righteousness. Then why does she again curse Krishna after the battle? What kind of a mother is she?
It's a good question.
In a way, we've already answered the question, because it is all about a conflict of dharma. What you stated about Gandhari is not very different from what Amish had earlier said, that there is a trade-off between my being a good mother or a good wife or being on the side of dharma. Now this is the simple part. The more complicated part, on which debates will continue, is the role of Krishna in the Mahabharata war, which is at the background of Gandhari cursing. And the question that Gandhari asked is a very simple question, which people ask even today, that it was in Krishna's powers to prevent the Kurukshetra war. So why did Krishna not prevent it? And there are different levels at which one can answer this. I will not even attempt them. At one level, one can answer this as saying that Krishna's motivation was such that it is impossible for us as human beings to try and understand his reasons for doing what he did. A second level at which it can be answered is Krishna may have been divine, but he was in human form. So there are limitations as to what he could do and what he could not do, or what he should do and what he should not do. Krishna could have turned it around and asked, as he did tell Uddhava when Uddhava asked him the same question, that before gambling, did Yudhishthira ask me? Because the objective of Krishna's descent is, after all, to teach people about dharma and karma, not to carry out their dharma and karma for themselves. At a completely different level, if we reduce Krishna to the level of an ordinary human being, which is not what I am suggesting we do, and I go back to a comment that was made by Nandini earlier, look at the kingdoms then. Powerful, powerful kingdoms all over the place. Jarasandha, then Bhagadatta, the Panchalas, the Kekais, Kangsha, Shishupal, Chedis, and the Yadavas being compressed from all sides, being driven out of Mathura, having to flee to Dwaraka. The Kurukshetra war is against the context of all of these kingdoms being progressively destroyed, not simply in the course of the Kurukshetra war. Matrimonial alliances with the powerful Kuru kingdom, through them matrimonial alliances with Drupad, with Virat, the destruction of Shishupal, the destruction of Jarasandha, all of that. At the end of it, what happens? Who rules in Hastinapur? Who rules in Indraprastha? The person who rules in Hastinapur is Abhimanyu's son, whom Krishna has resurrected in some fashion, Parikshit, whose son is Abhimanyu Subhadra's. And remember, the Yadavas were somewhat matriarchical. Yeah. Who rules in Indraprastha? A direct descendant of the Yadavas. If we were to reduce Krishna's action to purely human level, which I'm not suggesting for a moment we do, then this is a story of the Yadavas coming to power in Delhi.